Chelsea, and I'm a registered cardiovascular and general sonographer with 7 years of experience. Today, I'm at National Ultrasound comparing the Z6 with the brand new Mindray Z60. The Mindray Z60 is a new upgraded model of the Mindray Z6. The Mindray Z60 ultrasound system is a perfect solution for the practice looking to perform consistent OBGYN, basic cardiac, vascular, and general imaging exams. We wanted to highlight the key differences between the original Mindray Z6 and the new Mindray Z60 models. The Z60 increased the transducer lineup from the Z6 to now include the C6-2P curved linear probe with higher IQ, the 7L4BP linear probe with higher IQ, and the P7-3P cardiac probe with higher frequency. New software features include 4D and iLive imaging, making the Z60 an affordably competitive option against GE's 4D machines. Other new software options that were previously only available in higher range Mindray models are tissue Doppler imaging in color, power, pulse wave, and M-mode. Smart OB and Smart Face, these OBGYN options use auto detection and optimization of the fetal biometry and facial features in 4D. Natural touch elastography is available on the linear probes, and contrast imaging is available on the convex probes. iWorks is now available as a standard feature when included on the Z60 system. iWorks is a feature that includes standard work protocols built into the machine that can be turned on while scanning to make scanning more efficient by showing each step that should be included in a standard scan. The Z60 includes all the original Z6 features. Check out our other video on the Z60 to find out.
Hi, my name is Johnny Barge with Mindray Ultrasound, and this is the Mindray Z6 ultrasound machine. When you buy it and it comes to your facility, it'll come in a couple of boxes. You'll have the Z6 and the batteries in one box along with the power cord, and you'll have your transducers in a separate box depending on how many you bought, and then you'll also have a box of the UMT150 cart if you chose to purchase the cart. I strongly recommend following the directions for the UMT150 mobile cart, as it is simple to follow if you are following the directions. It takes about 30 to 45 minutes to put together. We'll discuss the setup of the equipment, which doesn't involve too much, and we'll talk about then the setup menu once we power on the machine and some of the basics. So if we look to the back of the machine, on the back of the Z6, we have a couple of ports where the transducers are plugged in, and once you take them out of their boxes, you can go ahead and see where they fit on the back of the machine here. And when you go to put them on, they just slide right in. And once they're in, you're not going to hear a click or a pop, but you'll just turn the little dial there and it'll be locked into place. And there are two ports back there. You can have two transducers plugged in at one time. On the back, you'll also see a space where the battery is. When you open up this little compartment, there'll be one battery included, and that will fit right into the compartment here. You just close that lid. And then you'll also see where the power cord inserts on the back of the machine in the bottom right corner. That's the gray cord that will be along with the machine in the box. Then you'll also see another little panel here that has a output for a VGA cord, which you see attached here. That's not included, but it's good to know that you can attach that to an external display. You'll also have an area that you can plug into a network cable. You'll see an area that you plug in an analog printer. And then you also have a couple of USB ports here for thumb drives. And you have a digital printer out, as well as S-video. A side note is that there are two more USBs on the side of the machine over here, which aren't visualized currently, but you'll see those as soon as you look at the Z6. As you put the Z6 on a table or a cart, wherever you're storing the machine in order to use it, you'll notice that there's two little tabs, one on each side of the machine. And when you pinch those, it'll bring the lid down and you'll see the full layout of the console and display here. Note up in the right corner is the power button, so we'll go ahead and press that power button, and it'll take about 25 to 30 seconds to boot up. Once your machine is booted up, again taking about 25 to 30 seconds, you'll see that on the very first thing you'll notice is a little login box. There is no password, and so what we'll do is we'll just use the trackball to move the cursor, and we'll use the set key to select login. Again, no password. From here, we're at the normal imaging screen, D-mode imaging screen. This is where we're going to want to choose the setup button, which is located toward the top of the keyboard. When I press that, What it'll do, it'll give me a menu on the left-hand side, and it'll also give me some tabs across the top depending on which setup tab I'm in. This first one is important as you set up your new equipment. This system preset gives you the region tab, which where you can put in your facility name, address, telephone number, as much as you'd like. You can choose your time zone, you can choose the date format, as well as a 12-hour versus 24-hour system date, make sure it's accurate, and then you can have your time change if you need to. Other tabs along the top, as you're getting used to your machine, is the general tab, which I recommend taking a look at. You'll see that you have the enable screensaver. That'll be selected automatically by default when you get your machine. Also, the standby, I believe, is selected as well. If you don't want those, you can just go ahead and uncheck them. And you can also change the duration in terms of how much time it takes for the standby and screensaver to come on. Depending on where you are and what you prefer, you can have those selected or deselected. Looking at the image tab, these are just things that will change your parameters when you're imaging and what you prefer, along with application. Underneath the OB tab, you may want to take a look and have this selected for the EDD for OB scanning. Underneath the key configuration tab, you see where you have the print button as well as save one and save two and your F1 buttons that you see on your console of your machine. You can select those and change what they control. If you have an analog printer and you select print over here, you can then change to analog print on the print option itself. If you'd like to have your save buttons do something other than save a still image or save a cine clip, that's where you see what other options you have. And you can look through those and explore to see what you have on each of these tabs. You can use the arrow button to get back here to all of the different functions. Once you move on to save two, for example, and you want to save that or put that as a save image to hard drive as well, you just select it on the right side. Looking down toward the bottom, you can see that you can change the color of the trackball, which can be kind of fun. There's different colors here. I prefer the blue, green, or the purple. They tend to show up the most vividly. You can change the key volume as well. And if you select that, you can either have it at zero, which would be a muted key volume with no volume, or one, two, and three. Depending on if you like to hear the sound of each keystroke or not hear it, you can change that as you wish. You can also change the key brightness as well as the trackball speed. Whatever changes that you make, you want to make sure that you click on save when you're finished with that using the trackball and the set key. That will save any of the changes that you've made. One thing I'd like to point out is that if you go to the admin tab underneath the system preset, this is where you can disable or enable that user account control that we saw when we first booted up the machine. Some people prefer to not have that pop up and it just goes right to the imaging screen, or if you wish, you can have it stay there and be enabled so in order to maybe slow down somebody if they were trying to get into it and you didn't wish them to. If you go to the other tabs down the left side, you can see things like exam preset. Whatever transducers you have plug in, you can find them in this drop-down list, and you can see which presets are loaded onto each of the transducer. If you move some back and forth, meaning these ones, exam selected would be what's on the transducer, what's on the left is the exam library, you can move them back and forth. If you're using a linear, you probably won't have any adult cardiac on there, so we maybe move that back over to the exam library. Other things you may look at are your measure preset, and that just goes along with each exam preset, as well as some of the networking and DICOM issues. I would recommend that you refer to the user manual when you're setting up any of the DICOM stuff, or giving your local sales rep or your clinical specialist a phone call. We can help you go through some of these things and coordinate. If you have a biomed person or clinical engineering, they're a great resource as well. If your machine came with the DICOM software, it would be on a USB thumb drive, and we would install it by going to the setup screen and going to maintenance. Again, that was something I recommend following the manual with and calling your local sales rep and or your clinical specialist. Again, I can't reiterate enough and stress enough that you want to click save anytime you've made changes. Without clicking save, some of the things that you may have done in terms of your system preset, entering your facility name and so on and so forth, will not be saved. it won't take about a few minutes to go back and redo that, but sometimes you make changes and you forget to press that save. So I just want to make sure that everyone knows that you go down here and you click save. And then once you're done with that, it'll take you back out to the setup screen. And now you've escaped back to your B-mode imaging screen, and now you're ready to go. If you have any questions, please don't hesitate to look through the manual, but also to give your sales rep and your clinical ultrasound specialist a call, and we can help you out. Thanks. Okay, so now that we're looking at the machine and we're ready to start imaging, we have everything set up. We want to look up here to the top right of the keyboard where we see the power button. You don't have to press and hold, you just press the power button and it'll boot up. And once we start, it only takes about 28 seconds to get to the imaging screen.
Okay.
And at that point, now you're ready to do step one, which is your patient information. And so when you pull that up, you're able to use the cursor and type in whatever you want. You can use the tab key to go between fields. And you can also use the trackball and the set key to be able to move it if you want to, you know, click into one field versus the tab. Some people like the tab button, some people like the trackball and the set key.
Okay.
And from there, then go ahead and use the trackball and scroll down to the OK on the bottom of the screen.
Hit set key?
Correct.
Okay.
Step two is you're going to select your probe in your exam preset. That's at the top of the keyboard.
Okay.
You'll see that you have your two transducers plugged in, your curvilinear and your linear transducers, and you see that they each have exam presets listed underneath them. So by scrolling through and then using the set key, you can go ahead and pick one.
Okay.
You can see that the system is very responsive. It switched from the curve to linear very quickly.
Mm-hmm. Great.
And now you're imaging. And things that we're going to look at now are making slight adjustments of your image.
Okay.
And so we see right here that there is a menu on the left-hand side of the screen, and this rotary navigation key allows us to scroll through that menu, and when you press on one of the options, such as persistence, then you can adjust that number.
Mm.
And then to be able to scroll again, you press down on the rotary nav key and move back. And what that does is that it will change some of your image quality aspects on your image.
Okay. Great.
So Julie, now that the machine is on and you've selected your patient information and probe and your exam preset, we're going to talk about how to optimize the image.
Okay.
So that, you know, as you put down the transducer and you see whether it's too bright or too dark, and the gain level, you can look and see that you have the little knob right there that says gain and eye touch. As you turn it counterclockwise, it becomes darker, and when you turn it clockwise, it becomes brighter. You'll see that knob also, aside from saying gain, says eye touch.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you press that knob down, you'll see in the top right corner of the screen, eye touch appears in that list of some of your image qualities, such as your frequency, depth, gain, frame rate.
Mm-hmm.
Eye touch is there. And what eye touch is an auto optimize for the machine.
Oh, that's nice.
To disable that, go ahead and press that gain eye touch knob for about 2 or 3 seconds. You'll find that it disables it. You'll see that it disappears from that column of words.
Mm-hmm.
So that is something that you can use on and off depending on, you know, each user and each exam preset as well as each patient.
I like it. Okay.
And also now if you look to the right of the eye touch and gain, you'll see that you have your TGCs as well as your focus, mm-hmm. your frequency, and your depth and your zoom.
Mm-hmm.
So one knob controls your focus as well as your frequency, being able to jump in and out of harmonics as well.
Mm-hmm.
So where the green dot is next to focus,
that's the active.
Correct. You can turn the knob and you'll see that that focus moves up and down.
Okay.
Now if you go ahead and press on that knob, you'll see that you go to your frequency and THI, which is your harmonics.
Oh, right here.
And in that list again on the screen, yep, you see that harmonics, the frequencies at the top. And as you twist that knob, you go between your fundamental frequencies as well as your harmonic frequencies.
Okay.
And so once you find the frequency that you want to be at, then you can press the knob again to go back to focus, because that might be something that you use more often, depending on, you know, what you're looking at. Correct. So just below that knob, the second knob, you see depth and zoom. You'll obviously use the depth more often than the zoom. And as you turn that, you can see that you get your depth in centimeters on the right side adjusting.
Mm-hmm.
And if you press the knob, you go to zoom, and it'll give you a box And you can move that box, that's your zoom box, with the trackball. And to change the size of your zoom, you can use the set key.
Okay.
And once you find that, you can hit the set key again. And now if you press the zoom, you go ahead and zoom in on that.
Oh, I see.
Okay. To disable the zoom, you go ahead and press the knob one more time. It'll take you back to your depth, and it'll also unzoom your image.
Great.
Talking about the TGCs a little bit, that's time gain compensation. Most users will leave those down the middle or slightly oblique from the left to the right. Mm-hmm. And what those control are the brightness on one level of your image. And if you think about the top TGC as your skin level, and the bottom TGC as deep as you are on the screen, you can see if you kind of slide those and play with them that they control the brightness just at each level of depth. Now that you're scanning, Julia, we're going to talk about the modes. You can see that B mode is illuminated in backlit orange, and that's just general basic 2D scanning. Right next to it is M mode, color, and pulse wave Doppler. So you have all your modes right in a row. And let's go ahead and start with M mode first. When you press it, you go have and have your green line there, and you can move it back and forth with the trackball. And the update function allows you to then start sampling. You're going to use that for fetal heart rates, pneumothorax, and emergency medicine. There's a lot of use for M mode.
Okay.
To be able to turn that on and off, you can either hit M mode again, or you can press the B mode button. That'll always bring you back home. It's a general basic 2D imaging. Right next to it is your color Doppler. When you press color Doppler, it brings up your box. If you want to change your box size, you can hit the set button. That'll allow you to use the trackball to go left and right, up and down, and then set allows you then again to move wherever you want the color box to be.
Great.
You can use the steer button here, which is like a quick steer for being left, right, or vertical, as well as on the menu that we spoke of a little bit earlier using the rotary navigation function.
Okay.
When you want to invert, that's on the menu, which you're going to use the rotary nav key for.
And so do I press it?
You'll just turn it. Yep, and you'll see that you'll go down there to invert. And then once you get to invert, then you press it and turn it again. Now you can see that your color's been inverted. That might be one of the few times that you're going to change and use that rotary nav key to find that invert. You'll see other imaging parameters on there, and that's a good time to refer to your user manual for some of those other parameters.
Because these are a lot of things that we wouldn't normally change: persistence, line density, packets. I mean, we don't normally make those adjustments.
Correct.
But invert, steer, which is nice, but here's a quick key to do it here.
And most of your image presets are going to be very good at honing in on the majority of what you're doing. You know, if you need
to change,
if you want to change your scale, that quick key for scale allows you to press it, and then you can use the rotary nav key, and you'll see on the side of your screen how you're changing the scale. But again, those image presets tend to be pretty sharp and dialed in for the majority of what you do.
Good.
So go ahead and hit the B mode, bring us back to 2D basic imaging. And now we'll talk about the pulse wave Doppler. When you hit pulse wave Doppler, you bring up your cursor with your sample volume, and you can see that your angle is already there for you. Here's where steer comes back into play, that quick key, so it goes left, right, and vertical.
Oh, that's nice.
And that's automatically set for you at 60 degrees to be hopefully parallel with the vessel walls. But we all know that we need to make some adjustments every now and again, so that's where your rotary navigation will allow you to change on this menu your quick angle. And when you press quick angle and press down the rotary nav key, it goes between your 60, 60, and 0. And then if you press it again and scroll down to angle, that's where you have your fine angle adjustments for just individual angle one at a time. And when you're ready to start sampling, that's when you're going to hit the update button. You do have other options, again, in terms of your parameters for your pulse wave, that I would refer you to the user manual to change some of these things. Things like scale and baseline can be found on those quick keys.
So I press it and then I rotate.
Yep, because you'll see that it becomes backlit orange, and that means, again, that it's active and allows you then to turn the rotary nav key. And scale, likewise, when you press it, you can see that scale adjusts.
Yep.
And you see that scale over on the right-hand side of your spectral analysis.
And then I just hit update if I come off of my vessel or something, I can hit update.
Yep, and you go back to live imaging. You'll see that you do have other options here in your menu, which you're going to use your rotary nav key for to be able to scroll through those. If you go up to your where it says B at the top of the image, you do have the ability to click through and then bring you back to some of your other parameters depending on the mode. And okay. So it'll take a little bit of time. You just play with it and you won't hurt anything just by playing with it and figuring out your machine. But that user manual does a nice job of pointing out some of the things that are a little bit more advanced.
Okay. And again, if we were to make a lot of adjustments and say, oh no, how do I get back to what Mindray thinks is the proper parameters for this exam, you would just go to probe?
Yes, you would. Yep. If you hit probe, that'll allow you to bring up both of your transducers, or just one transducer, whichever is plugged in, and you see your list of image presets and go ahead and select the same one or a different one, whatever you want to go into, and that'll bring you back to the default settings.
Right, to get you back to normal if you've gone a little crazy with your adjustments.
Yeah. So among those modes, you also have a dual screen option, which is great. So if you want to press dual screen, you can go ahead and get in there, and I'll show you that you have a dual screen for, compressibility of the vessels, showing normal versus abnormal, any pathology that you want to use. And you can see that M is bright on the screen that you're actually live with. If you hit dual, you'll go back and forth between the two. And as you come to the point in which you find what you want, and you hit dual, and you can go back and forth, like you compress the vessel and hit dual, and then you can show that the vessel is patent and open, then you can hit freeze, and what you'll see now is that you have the ability to use the trackball to cine loop back and find the frame that you want on that one. And if you want to go back to the other side of the screen, hit dual, you see that M is bright, and you can then cine loop back to the point at which you want to be at in order to save now your image. Saving images, you'll see that you have two save buttons. One is labeled save one and one is labeled save two. Typically, those are set up just out of the box that one will save an image and save two will save a cine loop. When we talk about the duration of cine loop, that's when we'll look under the setup tab and talk about cine loop duration. But for now, you understand that save one is a save image and save two is a cine loop. And to do the cine loop, you do want to make sure that you are frozen, or else you'll get a little message that says go ahead and freeze first before you hit the cine for the save two button.
Correct. So let me just get out of dual by hitting the B.
Yes. Okay. Yeah, B mode again is your B mode, kind of go home button.
So if I swept through just like this and I hit freeze and save two as a cine clip, it's saving what I did
retrospectively.
3 seconds before.
Yes.
4 seconds before retrospective. Yep. Okay.
It is.
Good. And then can we talk about these buttons?
Yeah,
here?
So go ahead and hit freeze. And so as you're imaging through and now you want to change your depth, if the carotid is a little deeper, you can see that if you turn that knob that you get a little bit more depth. And then right above it, focus is what you're going to want to change oftentimes when you are changing your depth because of what you're looking at. You want to make sure that it's crisp and clear.
So you want your focal zone parallel or in line with
Yes.
the specific area.
Yep, exactly.
And then if I press the button, I'm switching to frequency, which a lot of people may or may not want to manipulate, but the focus and the depth are two of the main
They are. Parameters. And that's why they're on top in terms of those two items per knob. The focus is something you change more often than your frequency, and the depth is something you change more often than using a zoom function.
So can you tell me the difference between zoom and iZoom?
Yes, I can. So when you're looking at this knob here and you see depth and zoom, go ahead and change by pressing down on the button. You see that you get a box, and that's going to be where you want to zoom on your image. You can change that box size by using the trackball and the set key, and then when you press the set key again, it'll lock it in, similar to how you did it with the color box.
Yeah.
And now when you've pressed the knob again, you've actually zoomed in, and when you turn that knob, you can see that you're zooming in quite a bit.
Right.
So that's a true zoom function on the system.
Okay.
Now if you press zoom again, it'll go back out to your regular image, and you're back to depth on that option.
Okay.
Now what we have on the machine, which is special to Mindray, is called the iZoom, and we have that on the F1 key, and that's the way it should be with your key configuration.
Everyone's system.
Yeah, as it comes to you. And we'll talk about that under the setup in a different chapter.
Okay.
But F1 will actually be an iZoom, so go ahead and press that and it'll up sample the image. So you're not zooming in, so you don't have any, you don't lose any pixels. It actually keeps the image nice and sharp. And so this is like a medium, and then I like to refer to the next, if you hit F1 again, the iZoom, then you go full screen.
Oh, I see.
You have the ability to go between kind of a normal size, a medium, and a full up sample to large screen. So if you press it again, you'll see that F1 key becomes non-backlit orange and is back to where you see your images saved along the bottom and your patient information on the banner.
That's nice.
that's one thing I want to take a look at down here. You saved images, you saved some clips, and you'll see that those are populated down as thumbnails on the bottom. And the difference between those, and it may not be, you know, readily, you know, something that you see right away, but you look and see that it has this little reel that, like a movie strip. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And if you press or hover over that with your trackball and the cursor.
So cursor button.
Yep, cursor button, correct. And then you go over, and if you hover over it, you can see that it makes it a little bit bigger, but if you double press the set button, now it'll make it bigger, and you can actually see that image there. Likewise, if you double press the set button on one of the cine clips, it'll run right through. Yeah, and you'll see that it's playing through all those frames of the cine clip right there. And so now, if you wanted to stop that cine clip for some reason, you can use the trackball, and you can see that you're scrolling back and forth.
Can I save a still image?
You can.
There?
Yeah, oh, go ahead and press save one. Yep, there you go, and so you can see it populates right there.
Oh, that's good.
Now to go back to then live scanning or to not be in this cine clip that you're reviewing, go ahead and hit the freeze button. You can see it was back in orange.
And you're back to normal.
Yep. And we'll talk about what the garbage can mean, which would be trash, and the arrow, which would be send to, which is all covered under image management and how to export things. So we'll cover that as well.
So a lot of these, just to review, a lot of these parameters that we're seeing under the rotary navigation tool are things, some we may or may not want to change as we get more and more comfortable with the machine.
Yeah, absolutely. We always encourage people to, you know, this is your machine and we want people to use it and find out what they like and how to customize it. That being said, there are some things that are in each image preset, each exam preset that are, you know, locked in for you. Well, for every user that's going to grab it, that they don't need to make some of those adjustments, but the manuals do a nice job of a quick reference guide, as well as contacting your local sales rep and product specialist.
Great.
In this section, we're going to talk about measuring.
Okay.
And when you look at the keyboard, you'll see that there's a measure option versus a caliper option. Measure option is going to be very important depending on which exam preset that you're in. So let's go ahead and click back on the probe button just up at the top of the screen. You'll see your transducers that are plugged in as well as each exam preset. Go ahead and pick whichever one you want, such as carotid.
Okay.
Now we're in our carotid exam preset and we're going to, let's take a color and pulse wave image with the measurements of the common carotid artery.
Here's my handy steer here.
Yep, there you go. You have your pulse wave, and now you can heel toe your transducer a little bit, line it up, you can update again. There you go. So now, once you're satisfied, you hit baseline, go ahead and use the rotary nav key and adjust it down a little bit.
There we go.
Perfect.
Okay. Now I'm happy.
Freeze, and now here's where you're going to take a measurement. You hit measure, and that'll bring up our calculation package.
Mm.
And again, depending on which exam preset you're in, that's going to go ahead and select which calculation package comes up. If you are in a different imaging mode, such as thyroid, we get, you know, different thyroid lobes and, you know, abilities to measure different things. Whereas when we're in our carotid package, you actually see that you have right, left, proximal, and distal, and then all of your vessel segments.
So we choose which side we're on.
And then you choose the segment that you're in. And then you would choose which.
If I'm ICA or CCA.
Which vessel. And you're all the time you're using the trackball and the set key.
Okay, so let's go to 2 point. This is the most basic.
Correct, and that's what the default is set for as well.
Okay.
So now that you're just using the trackball and the set key, you've taken out and you've measured your peak systolic and diastolic. You use the set key to move both, and then you get your measurement. It'll also show you up there in the top right what your results are.
Okay.
And so now if you freeze, you go back to live imaging. Mm-hmm. And this is where now, if you're scanning and you're in these modes, go ahead and hit update for me. And hit freeze. And now if you hit the caliper button, you're gonna find that you just have kind of a generic list of things. You don't see your vessel segments. Mm-hmm. You don't see that you have right, left, proximate, distal. What you do have is velocity, heart rate, time, all those menu options. Again, that's fine because, and that's fine, you know, if you want to just take a measurement that isn't necessarily part of your calc package. That's the difference between measure and caliper. Measure is really important for whichever exam preset you're in to give you your right calc package, whereas caliper is going to be more of a generic measurement, which will differ a little bit. So go ahead and hit B mode just like you did. And now if you wanted to measure, you know, maybe the vessel diameter, you can hit freeze and caliper. And what that'll do is it'll give you some B mode measurement calipers. And you see that you have distance, trace, ellipse, as well as some other things. And this is where you're using the trackball and the set key to go between those things. And let's say that you have...
Set and update to go between.
So now that you've hit freeze and you're back, you hit the caliper button. You have your caliper there and you can use the trackball. So go ahead and put it on a point of the vessel that you think you'd want to measure from.
Okay.
Now hit set. And let's say that you trackball down to the bottom and you don't really like where that top caliper is at.
Okay.
You can hit the update button and you'll go back to the top caliper. If you hit update again, it'll actually change back to the bottom one and allow you to adjust. If you're not happy with where that bottom caliper is and you just want to go back to your original caliper, you can hit the back button. And now it will give you back to your original crosshair caliper there.
And if I wanted another set, I just hit set.
Set, and then move the trackball again.
Okay.
And just go back and forth. Now, if you did your two measurements there, hit set, and it'll lock in. You can see that that has turned white on the screen. Now you have locked in measurements. Let's go ahead and hit the save button, which will save that still image. If you also wanted to do an elliptical measurement or some other sort of measurement, just use the trackball to go over to your menu that's in the top left corner, and you can find which one you maybe want to do, and let's just choose ellipse. And now you have your cursor, and you have an elliptical measurement. So you have multiple ways of taking multiple measurements.
And you update back and forth to change that. Okay.
Yep, so update will always take you to the other cursor, whereas back will take you to the original cursor.
Right, and then set to set it.
Yep. And you can use that trackball and the set key. Use those quite a bit. So, I mean, anytime that you're measuring something or moving the cursor, things like that, the trackball and the set key really are important functions on the machine.
Great. What if I don't like a measurement? What if I put something in the calc package under measure and I end up taking another one that's better and I want to delete that previous one?
Yep, so it'll save up to 3 measurements per segment or for per measurement. And what happens is you have taken multiple measurements and we're still in the carotid setting. So if we hit on our report, which is up here, that'll pull up all of the calcs that you've done in your calc package, whether it's an OB or an abdomen or a vascular, you'll go to that exact thing. And this is something that we'll talk about again in our report. But to know that you have the ability to go in here and delete them. So let's say you've taken 3 on each segment, you know that your last one is the one that you really want to keep. You can go ahead and click on those and just delete them. It's straightforward.
Okay. Do that under the report chapter.
And that's how you measure versus caliper.
Right, it's easy.
In this chapter, we're going to discuss annotation, some of the other features that you can use aside from just imaging. We see that we have a couple of the buttons over here on the left side of the keyboard. One that says body marker, one that says ABC comment, and we also have an arrow, which is just to the left of the space bar. If you want to just start typing on the screen, you're more than welcome to do that. So go ahead and actually hit freeze, and then just start free typing. And you see that you get text, and you see that the ABC comment key is automatically engaged. And when that happens, that means that you're just in the texting sort of annotation mode. You also see that on the menu, now where you've changed some, before you changed some imaging parameters, now you have a bank of words that you can use for each exam preset that you're in. Right now we're in an OB2-3, which is second, third trimester setting for exam preset. And we also see now that we have those sort of words that are often used for annotation. So that's a nice bank of words to be able to use without having to free type. And if you want to pick up and move a word, you can use the trackball, and once it turns green like you did when you hover over it, you can use the set key now to pick it up and move it wherever you want to.
And if I wanted to add like maybe lateral, I could add this.
Yes, it'll place that word where you just dropped the previous word.
Nice.
And then you can rearrange them as you want to. Let's say that you've added those words now to your screen, to your image, and you want to get rid of some of those just letters that don't make any sense. Go ahead and click the set button. And now you can hit the clear button, which is just below the ABC comment key. And that'll go ahead and take away those letters that weren't supposed to be there. If you hit clear again, what you'll see happen is it'll delete other text on the screen. If you want to be able to use this bank of words, another method of doing so is to use that rotary navigation key. And if you twist it, it'll go between the words. And if you want then to add it to your image, go ahead and press down on the navigation rotary key. And it'll put it there. So sometimes people will use those in order to, you know, almost work it as in the order of images that they're taking.
Mm-hmm. Does it automatically put it where your cursor was, or
yes,
is there a home set button?
On here, it'll automatically put your put it where the cursor
where
was.
The cursor
exactly.
Was. Okay, so if I'm up here or if I'm down here, that's where it'll.
Yes, and so then when you're using that navigation rotary key, it'll put it where that was at for the cursor.
Okay, good.
So go ahead and clear those off. And so that's one way, you know, you just were free typing before. Mm-hmm. Now go ahead and hit the freeze button like you were live imaging and scanning again. Mm-hmm. You could hit freeze, and then if you hit the ABC comma key, that essentially does the same feature mm-hmm. as before when you just started typing. Mm-hmm. It popped it up there for you and engaged the annotation. Mm-hmm. And you're just moving amongst mm-hmm. those words. And you can see that when you scroll down with that rotary navigation key, it actually scrolled through your list of words. Mm-hmm. You can go through and you see on the bottom you can change the size of the font. And mm-hmm. you can also change the arrow size, which we'll discuss the arrow in a moment. And as well as doing custom, custom allows you to actually go through and change the order of those words in the word bank, as well as delete and add words. So you're not stuck with what is given there, but this gives you a really nice starting point mm-hmm. For a lot of users, because those are catchphrases and words that are used often. And again, in each exam preset, if you found that you wanted to use other words in a different preset, if you clicked on the OB23, you get a little menu that pops up that shows you all the other exam preset annotation libraries.
So if I went to kidney, it would give me a new set.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's yep. nice. Okay.
Yep.
Great.
So that essentially is how you annotate, either by free typing, mm-hmm. and you can just type on the screen, or by going through and doing the ABC comma mm-hmm. key. So go ahead and hit freeze, and now we'll talk about some of the body markers. Mm-hmm. Body marker is right here. Mm-hmm. And so again, depending on which exam preset that you're in, you
we'll
can
give
go
you a ahead. Different set of
yeah,
body markers.
Yeah. So right. go ahead and hit the body mark there, and you can see again because we're in that OB second, third trimester, you get different pictures of you know a fetus, you know position.
Right.
And you can use that rotary nav okay. key and to be able to scroll through those and kind of see some of the various body markers that you can use. And then to select it, you can either press down on the rotary nav key, mm-hmm. or you could also have used that trackball on the set key, mm-hmm. like we did for a lot of other things. Mm-hmm. You'll see that you get this little green. You know, it looks like an eye, mm-hmm. but what that indicates is the transducer and how you're holding the transducer relative to how you're scanning. And there's a little notch on there which you'll find corresponds to the notches on the transducer. Mm-hmm. In order to, you can actually manipulate where that is pointed by using the rotary nav key, and you can see that you're changing the orientation from a longitudinal to transverse.
Right.
And so on and so forth. When you're happy with where that's positioned, you can hit the set key and you can see it'll turn to yellow.
Oh,
there you
I'm
go.
Sorry.
Nope, you're good.
Okay.
No, it's perfect. You can see that it's yellow on there
oh,
now.
Because yeah.
mm-hmm. A lot of people will come across that where they maybe hit set one too many times and they'll think that they affected something, but in reality, it just locked it in there and now you're ready to roll.
Okay.
If you want to pick that up and move it or re-engage mm-hmm. that body marker, use the cursor button there and you can hover over it and you can hit the set button. That engages where you put the body marker in terms of on your screen. And then if you actually want to change where that transducer mm-hmm. is, you can press set again mm-hmm. and then double click kind of on that in that area
where
with the set
is.
Button.
Yep.
Double press again. Yep, there you go. And now you've re-engaged where the transducer and the notches and so on and so forth.
That's nice.
Yep. And then so from there, you're going to do arrow. Yeah.
Okay.
And so arrow is right next to the space bar. And so here's where we talked about where arrow size is. So arrow, you know, starts out as small by default, and you can see that as you're turning the rotary nav key, that you're actually positioning the arrow differently.
Ah, yeah. So you can move the position, but you can mm-hmm. also rotate.
Correct. Yep. You can move it with the trackball,
really
but then you
tiny.
Can then you can rotate. Yeah. So let's go ahead and drag your trackball over to where we see the arrow size, and let's go ahead and select. Up to medium and even go larger. And now you have large, and then go ahead and bring the trackball back over.
Ah.
And now you have a large arrow.
Yeah.
And so go ahead and hit the set button for me. That'll give you a second arrow. Now the only arrows that'll show up on your screen when you save an image are the ones that are yellow that you've pressed set in order to keep on there.
Mm.
And that's really important because sometimes people will feel like maybe they have that arrow and they aren't wanting it. But just remember, until you set it there, it won't actually stay, which is, you know, one of those just things that you remember as you go. And so as you save that image again, you see that it populated down there. What's more is that you can use the trackball to go up to your arrow there. and you can select it with the set key, and now you can move it, and you can actually rotate it again using that rotary nav key. So there's a lot of, you know, what we call post-processing things that you can do with your body markers, or your arrows and your annotations, moving them, adjusting them, manipulating them, things like that.
And you could just have many.
Yeah, lots of arrows, you know, so if you're pointing out, you know, something that you wanted to draw attention to, whether it's pathology or normal finding or whatever it might be, there's a lot of ways to do that.
And then clear takes it away.
Yep, clear, regardless of body markers versus annotation versus arrows, the clear button will always then remove that. Yep, exactly.
In this chapter, we're going to discuss image management, which includes reviewing your images, looking at a report, adding images to a report, being able to delete images that you've taken and don't want anymore, and also we'll talk about sending those images across to whether it's a thumb drive or a network cable that you're connected to, all those things. So now when you look at the screen, you see that on the bottom you have your images and your cine clips that we've taken throughout the course of a study. We can go ahead and press our review button, which is up here on the top of the keyboard. And that'll allow us to look at all of our images and clips in what we see as small thumbnails, medium thumbnails, and full screen. And what that does, it just makes the images bigger, so the aspect is different. And when you're in this large screen mode, put your cursor down on the image here, and then try using this rotary nav key to twist through. That's a quick way. So if you go into full screen, you're able to evaluate those images a little bit better. And then you can use that rotary nav key to navigate through all of your images. And you'll see that as you scroll, it obviously goes up and down your scroll bar, depending on which way you're going. If you go back to your small or middle, small is probably the easiest way to be able to select multiple images or to delete or send to. So go ahead and press on, you know, one of your images there, as well as maybe one of the cine clips. And in order to do that, try holding down the control key and the set button, and maybe skip then down to number 11 and hold down the control and the set key. And that, there you've selected multiple studies, or multiple images rather. You'll see that you have the garbage can pop up as well as the arrow. These are little quick keys or quick links. And what that does is if you click on the delete with the set key, it'll say, are you sure you want to do that? And for this sake, we'll just click cancel maybe.
Okay.
But that would be how you would delete, you know, three at a time or multiple at a time. There is a select all function down at the bottom. If you did that, obviously it selects all of your images and cine clips. Here you would be able to delete. And if you do that, it's always going to give you a prompt, like, are you sure you want to do that? Which is a nice fail-safe.
Right.
Because oftentimes, you know, you might just bump it accidentally, and then you can cancel, like you did there. Here's where you also, you could deselect all. But since everything is selected currently, let's try going to the send to option. And what that will do is it'll allow you to have your different targets where you're going to send it. Right now, you know, if you had a network printer connected or the iStorage, which is on the system. But also I have a thumb drive, which I'll plug in here, and we'll talk about in another chapter how we have four USB ports, two on the side and then two on the back of the machine. So I'm gonna go ahead and we'll plug this in, and it'll take just a moment and we'll hear the machine recognize it, and it'll go ahead and it'll pop up here. And let's click cancel, and we'll come back in.
Okay.
And now go ahead and go to send to. And now it sees, it recognizes that you have your thumb drive there. It also shows you that, you know, there's no folders or no active studies, anything on that thumb drive. You'll see that down on the bottom, it tells you the options for being able to export. And the JPEG AVI is the most common way for the exporting, so you can plug it into a computer or transferring that a Windows-based or a Mac or anything will recognize those files. If you want to change to, you know, bitmap AVI or a TIFF AVI, you just use the trackball and the set key to move those over. And you can just change those. And then if you want to have your report included, which we'll talk about in just a minute, you just select that box. It's a PDF report which comes across with it. And when you're done and you're ready, you do click that OK button. We'll go ahead and do that. And now down at the very bottom, you're going to see this little task management. If you leave your mouse over it, your cursor, it'll say task management. Let's click on it. You can see those arrows going across there. It'll show you that in your storage media task that you're sending, it'll show you your progress, your study's name, the patient's name, and I'll say where it's going, and then also the content as well as the date. So you can go ahead and hit the exit button, but that's a good way to know if you're sending multiple studies across, how long it's taking depending on the images and the cine clips that are stored on there. Let's go ahead and hit exit while that's transferring. And you can use the trackball and go to exit there. So that was our review. Mm-hmm. Let's click on report, which is right next to review. Here is where we've taken a bunch of images and a bunch of clips. Mm-hmm. You can select the report type that we're in. Let's try going to our...
Let's go to carotid.
Yeah, because we did some carotid images on there. Let's scroll down using the trackball and the set key.
Oh, trackball and set key.
And you can also use, okay. you just found out that you can also use the rotary nav.
I'm going back and forth.
That's right.
Yeah.
So here's where now looking at a report where we have, you know, three measurements taken on our proximal CCA, and we also have a couple measurements taken other places. If you want to delete one of these measurements, there's a way that you just use the trackball and the set key, and you can click in there with the set key, and then mm-hmm. you can just use the backspace button right there in order to delete that, and it'll actually remove it from your report. You can also change the method in which it's calculating from last to average to max and min.
Right.
So depending on where you are in the facility and what type of measurement you're taking, you can modify those options. I want to talk about the image select down here. Go ahead and click on that with the set key. And here's where on the left side, all the available images and city clips. I don't believe that it works with the city clips, but what you want to do is you can move images onto your PDF report, which is exportable,
really like
as we
that.
Saw. Yeah, it's a really,
really
it's a really great feature because oftentimes you want to take maybe some pathology that you saw, or if you're doing a fast exam in the emergency medicine department, there's a way that you just want to have a few images. So let's go ahead and select, just pick a few at random here, and then use the single arrow to move one over, and then we scroll down a little bit further and select one and use that single arrow. Mm. If you use the double arrow that you see on your screen, it's going to move all of your images over, which will just create a little bit longer sort of report. That being said, you do have the option of moving all the images back onto the available images side, which then won't, you know, you just start over and you move one at a time. That's what the single arrows are for.
And it looks like I can go back and forth. If I move something over and I find out later I want this is better, I can just select this one and move it back.
Correct.
Yeah.
Yep, so now we'll click on OK there with the set key and the trackball. Now let's go to our print view. So here now we're gonna see your facility's name. We can add a logo and we can talk about that in the system setup link. It'll also show us all of our measurements and also show us the images that we push on the PDF. And if you use the trackball and the set key to slide down to page 2, scrolling down that way. Yep, so if you have multiple images, you know, say 2 or 3, 4, it'll push them down there as well as on your comments. Let's go ahead and go back to close. And here's where you have the ability to go to your other pages and to add comments. If you go to next, this is where you'd scroll through the couple pages of carotid measurements or OB measurements, abdominal measurements, and you could put in that what your comments were, and those will be added to the report as well.
Okay. Anything you wanted to save comment or just hit okay?
Go ahead and click on okay. Yep. And so now what that'll do is you have your report saved, and we talked about in our review. Let's go back just to review to show people how to do that. Here's all your images and your Cindy clips that you took. You can actually view your report from clicking up there in the top corner, and it'll show you, you know, if you went back to your carotid, you
right.
know, we kind of mixed some studies in there together, that you would see that all of your measurements and then as well as your comments are there. And
do I have to take a picture of the report page? Do I have to save it right here, or does it?
Some people will. Some people will save images of their report page.
But it's not necessary if I'm exporting a PDF.
Correct.
Okay,
yep.
That's really nice. Actually.
Yep. If you are sending it to a PAX viewer, you're exporting to a thumb drive, some people will save images of each page of the report, but that's not necessary per se.
Yeah. I mean, I think that's a habit because not a lot of systems do that.
Right.
But I like it.
Yep. And so, you know, depending on which sort of report that you're in, you can, you know, if you're doing an OB, there's an analyze and growth where you can select which, you know, everything that you saw, you know, if you're doing all your growth measurements, there's a way you just click on analyze and growth and it'll show you all the different, you know, if you're doing a biophysical profile, all those different things that you can measure will be there in each report package, again, depending on which exam precept you're in. And there's a different way, you know, you're doing the whole page versus 100%, and that just zooms it up and so you can see what you're looking at a little bit more closely. And then you just use the trackball and the set key to close out.
It's very nice.
And then when you're finished, you can either click OK or you can also hit your review and report button right there. Yep.
Okay. So when I'm going to send it over and I select which images I want to send over either, let's say I'm gonna select them all, I'm gonna send to, and this is where I choose. If this is clicked, that means the whole report page in a PDF is going over with it.
Yes.
Okay, that's good.
Yep, so you want to make sure that your target where you're sending your images or your study to is selected. You want to just verify that it's the sort of image that you want. And that's the study that we sent over a few minutes ago. See it there on the thumb drive now.
Great. Does it automatically save all of this to the hard drive of the system, or do I have to send it there?
No, as long as you're saving images during your study, they will be saved on the hard drive until you physically go in and delete them. So there's not a worry that, you know, by sending them over onto a thumb drive that you're also deleting it off your gear system.
And I don't have to manually send it to the hard drive, it's just there.
Right. So go ahead and click cancel since we've already sent this one over, and let's go ahead and click exit.
Exit.
Oh, right on the screen, yeah, there you are.
What if I'm set up to a PAC system and if I ended the exam, does it automatically send it over? Do I have to manually send these?
There'll be an option that discusses that in setup.
Okay.
And also refer to your manual or contact your sales rep or your product specialist as well.
Depending on if you're sitting.
So. Yep. You know, there's a little more information that's inputted for a DICOM sort of setting. So that's where you want to, you know, coordinate with the right people. Absolutely. If you want to go back and review the patients that you've looked at and scanned previously and get into a study, the iStation button is our archive. So when you press the iStation button, you can see all the studies, and they'll go from most recent to more into the history of the machine. You can also click on the columns, and they'll order them by alphabetical if you click on name or the ID, which
date.
In this case is date time, or the exam date and time, exactly. And you'll see that the exam status is there, and you'll also see any of the other information that you put it in the machine. And so if you wanted to send a whole study from the machine instead of going into review, here's our iStation where we use the trackball and the set key. And now up pops a menu that says, that gives us our option. Go ahead and click the set button there. It'll show you if you want to review images or go back into your patient information. And you can see that there's some options there. That's where you would delete an exam if you moved it. Now you want to free up some space.
Right.
You also have the ability to send exam. And so if you click on send exam, that's another fast way to jump into sending a whole study across. Yep, exactly. And we've seen the screen before just a few minutes ago where you picked where you're going, you're making sure the device is accurate, and then you're also making sure that the image type is accurate as well. So go ahead and click cancel since we don't need multiple of that study sent across. But you can see that you get those options, and that arc, that iStation is a really important button to remember because that is your archive and how you get back in. You have 24 hours to get back into a patient that you've done previously, and that's a HIPAA regulation. And so you can actually activate. You'll see that it's grayed out right now because we're active in that exam.
Mm-hmm.
But if you were to click on, and these are paused, but when you end an exam, if it's within 24 hours, you have the ability to jump back in it and add some images and things like that. So after you've gone into your iStation, you've reviewed patient information or sent them across to whichever modality you want to view it from or send it to, then you're essentially done. You've reviewed images and clips, and you've put them on your report and finished that out, and then you've also looked back into your iStation.
Does this system prompt you when it's time to start deleting things from the hard drive, or does it just delete them automatically, the oldest?
It'll go through and it'll start deleting from the oldest. And then you have a way of, if you hit the iStation button here, it'll show you, you can go in and you can find the percent
of open storage
of
left.
Yes, correct.
Yeah.
And so again, that's something that you probably want to refer to your user manual or contact your specialist.
Right. Very good.